right, wonderful. We are live. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight. We will be starting in about 30 seconds or so. We're just going to wait for folks to file on in from the waiting room. And I'm also going to launch us live on Facebook. So for those of you that have Facebook accounts, just know that we're also simulcasting on the Tewksbury Library's Facebook page. We'll give it another 10 seconds or so while we wait for folks to file in. For those who are comfortable, certainly no obligation, but for those who are comfortable doing so, let us know in the chat where you're joining us from tonight. So let us know what city or town you're watching from. No obligation, but if you're comfortable doing so, let us know in the chat where you're joining us from. Okay, that's always fun. All right, while we do that, let me just go over some things for tonight. First, I want to welcome you all. My name is Robert Hayes. I'm the Community Outreach Librarian and Head of Technical Services here at the Tewksbury Public Library. I want to thank the libraries in Andover, Chelmsford, North Reading, Tewksbury, and Wilmington for helping promote tonight's program. And also want to thank our sponsors, the Friends of the Tewksbury Public Library, and the friends of the libraries at those respective libraries as well. So just so folks are aware, we are in webinar mode, so Ty and myself cannot see you or hear you. We are recording tonight's presentation for future viewing though, and we're also streaming live to Facebook, as I mentioned. For those who registered and are with us live on Zoom, you'll be receiving a feedback survey from me tomorrow morning. Please fill that out. Let us know what you thought of tonight's event and what you'd like to see for future events from all of the libraries. So Q&A and chats are open. So if you have any questions or comments for Ty, feel free to get them in. Ty will take some of the questions throughout the presentation, but I suspect we'll get to most of them at the end. But feel free to keep them coming during the presentation. Ty is going to keep an eye on the chat and the Q&A. So let's put it this way. I scheduled this program to go about an hour. We'll probably go a little bit longer. You can anticipate us wrapping up somewhere in the ballpark of 8:15 or so. We'll be somewhat dependent on the number of questions that are asked. All right. And then one last thing. We are hosting, he's no Ty Burr, believe me, but we're hosting Frank Mendoza, who's a film instructor. He'll be with us next Thursday, April 22nd at 7 o'clock, and he'll be talking about the history of the Oscars. Okay. His presentation is entitled The Academy Awards, The Good, The Bad, and The Outrageous.
I'll show up for that.
There you go. I'm going to drop the registration link in the chat right now so you can learn more about that program and register if you're interested. And again, that's next Thursday at 7 o'clock, again, via Zoom. Okay, we'll get to the good stuff here. So tonight we're joined by Boston Globe film critic Ty Burr for a discussion and prediction of the 2021 Oscars. Calling all movie lovers, Boston Globe film critic Ty Burr will break down this year's slate of Oscar nominations and reveal his predictions. Bring your questions and be prepared to share your opinions, but no spoilers, please. So Ty Burr is a professional moviegoer. As I mentioned, I think three times now, he's the Boston Globe's film critic and cultural columnist, sometimes covering music, theater, books, and the internet. He has been at the paper since July 2002, coming up on 20 years almost. Mm-hmm. He previously wrote for Entertainment Weekly. Ty is the author of several books, including Gods Like Us on Movie Stardom and Modern Fame, The Best Old Movies for Families, and the ebook, 50 Movie Starter Kit, What You Need to Know If You Want to Know What You're Talking About. Clearly, I have no idea what I'm talking about. Ty is a member of the National Society of Film Critics and the Boston Society of Film Critics. In 2017, he was a finalist for the Pulitzer in Criticism. He studied film at Dartmouth College and New York University, and is currently, at least at the time of this bio, an adjunct professor in film and TV at Boston University. And Ty lives relatively nearby in Newton. So all, what is there, nearly 70 of us live here on this Zoom. Let's give a big virtual round of applause to Ty for joining us here tonight. And Ty, you can take it away. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, Robert. I would say it is nice to be here in Tewksbury virtually. I live in Newton, but I cover the waterfront. I look forward someday to actually doing this live and in person. That would be fun. I do a lot of these, and it's great to talk to people who are movie lovers and who, it's just the live aspect of it is a really nice, fun time. And I really look forward to your questions in the chat box. The way I do it normally is I sort of lead the conversation through the best picture nominees, and I've got trailers here that I am going to show, and discuss their chances at winning, and sort of detour down the alleys of best actor and best actress and supporting actors and cinematography and documentary and what have you as we go. This year, of course, is an extremely unusual year, as it has been for in all other respects. But it's been a very unusual year, A, for film, and B, for the Oscars and all awards. What's different this year? How has the pandemic affected the movie scene this year? All the major studio pictures got pushed back to 2021, and in some cases to 2022. So most of those were a lot of big action superhero movies, so franchise films of the sort that don't necessarily get nominated for Oscars, except maybe for visual effects. But there were some high profile films that, were being, put in position for the Oscar race, including Lin-Manuel Miranda's In the Heights, the Steven Spielberg remake of West Side Story. Those are both supposed to be two 2020 films that will be coming out later this year. So what that did was clear the decks for a wider variety of smaller independent films. So the majors didn't release any of their films. In some cases, they released them on streaming platforms. And in fact, one of the stories of this year that I'm not going to get into too much detail, except perhaps in the Q&A section, is really how the theatrical marketplace was shut down and into the vacuum rushed these streaming platforms and the studios setting up streaming platforms and in some cases arranging for their films to go either directly to the streaming platforms at the same time they're in theaters or very much shortly after than they used to go before. And this is something that of course greatly upsets the theater owners, but they haven't been in a position to do much about it this year. But what did happen this year was that the smaller independent art house films, theaters, like the Coolidge Corner in Brookline, like the Dedham Community Theater in Dedham. I don't know what kind of, maybe somebody can throw it into the chat box, what your independent theaters that you have out in your neck of the woods out by Tewksbury with, as opposed to the malls, the multiplexes. Many of those kept showing films virtually. And as the year went on, some of the multiplex, giants, the AMCs sort of joined in, but they still weren't showing the major studio stuff. The independent distributors, the independent studios still kept the movies coming through virtual online screenings. So you could sign up for those through the portal of your local independent theater and pay the ticket price and portion of that ticket price would go to the theater. So it helped everybody kind of stay afloat. So the irony is that, between the streaming giants, Netflix and Amazon, and Hulu, which are produced, have huge pockets now, deep pockets, and can afford to produce their own films. And Netflix in particular is pushing into the Oscar race with all the money it can spend because it wants to buy respect and more subscribers. Between them and the independent distributors, they are the real factors this year in the Oscar race, much more than the studios. They were sort of out of the picture. So that gives the Oscar race this year an unusual cast. The ones that seem like sort of what we would associate with big box office movies of previous years, and I'm thinking of Trial of the Chicago 7. That was a Netflix film. you know, that never saw theaters. It might have in previous years, and once we're out of the pandemic, the Netflix might still roll out their specialty films to, you know, unlimited theatrical releases to, well, in one case, it used to be to qualify for the Oscars, but now that's changed. What exactly, you know, next year, the conversation will be what qualifies as an Oscar movie? Does it need to be in a theater? It used to be, but the game has changed this year. So a lot of the rules are up in the air. Some changes in the Oscar rules this year. They finally, as I was telling Robert before, they used to have these two sound awards that nobody could tell apart unless you were a sound engineer. One was for sound mixing, one was for sound editing. They put them together into one category, best sound. This year is, again, and I think it's been 6 or 7 years now that they've had more than five Best Picture nominees. It now is anywhere between 5 and 10, depending on how many pictures get more than 5% of the nominated ballots. Next year, that changes to a hard 10. From now on, until they change the rules again, there's always going to be 10 Best Picture nominees. And again, that was done in order to widen the field to include, well, I think originally it was set up as a response to The Dark Knight, the Batman movie, the Christopher Nolan Batman movie, not being nominated for Best Picture. And a lot of fans squawked very angrily about that. And I think the Academy, in response, widened the field. Ironically, it's allowed some independent films, smaller independent films, like Moonlight, to get into the, which won a couple of years ago in a sort of famous upset, like last year's Parasite, first foreign language winner from Korea to win Best Picture. I don't know if those would have gotten into the mix if we'd had five nominees. So let's talk a little bit about the ones that are nominated. And again, unusually this year, when I do these talks, a lot of times, you know, half the audience will be people who are like hardcore film goers that have made it a point to go out and see as many of the nominated films as possible. And the rest are people who are like, you know, see whatever they can. This year, because almost all of the films are available for streaming, you can see all of them, just about all of them. I think all of them are now available for streaming on either on one platform or another, or sometimes, you know, across a number of video on demand platforms. So the nominees for Best Picture 2020 are The Father, Judas and the Black Messiah, Mank, Minari, Nomadland, Promising Young Woman, Sound of Metal, and The Trial of the Chicago Seven. And I would guess that the majority of people, I'm not necessarily speaking about you guys, but I would say that the majority of people have probably seen Trial of the Chicago Seven because it's on Netflix. Minari, because it's on Netflix, I believe as well, maybe. Mank, because it's all over Netflix. And I'll discuss the response to that film because it's got the most nominations of any pictures, 10 nominations. And it's probably the least liked by general audiences. And I'll talk a bit about that. There's a reason for that. I like the film, but I can certainly understand why a lot of people don't enjoy it. Let's sort of go through these. And I can, why don't I start with the one that is really been the front runner for Best Picture since it debuted at the Toronto Film Festival and the Venice Film Festival back in September. And this is crazy. That's how long the Oscar parade is now. It's 8 months long. Normally the Oscars are held, well, they used to be held in March. Then they were bumped back to February last year to be more competitive with the other award ceremonies like the Golden Globes and all the other awards. But this year, because of the pandemic, they pushed it back out. So it's at the end of April. It's April 25th. So that means from September to April, we've been having an Oscar conversation. And obviously, you know, by this point, I have a headache. And honestly, I think that's to the detriment of Nomadland because it's been the de facto front runner for 8 months now. And honestly, momentum, here's my theory, my blanket theory on what movie wins the Best Picture Award. The movie that wins the Best Picture Award is the movie that makes the individual Oscar voter feel the best about what they do, whether it's matters of craft or matters of social statement. The best that makes them feel the best about what they do at the moment they are filling out that ballot. And a week earlier, it could be the momentum could be with a different film. A week later, it might be with a different film. And that I think has an effect. That is why I think a couple of years ago when we had that crazy upset when Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway read the wrong card and announced La La Land had won Best Picture. Oops, no, it was Moonlight. Well, one of the reasons they stumbled over it, well, they've been handed the wrong card, but everybody assumed La La Land was going to win. It had already won a ton of awards leading up to the Oscars. It won a ton of awards on Oscar night. It was just sort of the de facto winner, but nope, this little sneak movie snuck in and won it. And I think that the talk about that movie was sort of cresting in the weeks before the Oscar and in the weeks before the ballots were in. And I think that really is a factor. So it may be that Nomadland has sort of run its course, or maybe it's still going to win. It was winning, it won Best Picture at the BAFTAs, the British Oscars, last week. So it still has a lot of legs. I don't know how many of you have seen it. Robert had it, and I were talking about it before we logged on. And he was saying he was disappointed with it. And one of the things we talked about, and this is the downside of an 8-month Oscar season. By the time you've come to Nomadland, you've heard so much about it and you're being sold it as the greatest film ever. By the time you see it, it's just a movie. It's a really good movie maybe, but the hype is so much up here that the reality is very, very hard to match. And that happens every year with the Oscars. So, and I feel bad about that. I feel in part that, you know, reviewers like myself have a role in that. You know, I gave it a 4-star review. That sets the bar maybe too high. And a lot of the reviewers see it way early in the game. So that's a factor to keep in mind. I do think it's a very good film. It's a quiet film. And I think, again, when you're told, oh, it's the best picture of the year, you're expecting bells and whistles and rockets going off. And this is a quiet film, but one that sort of takes the pulse of America in I think ways that are kind of fascinating. So I'm going to show a trailer. It's not the best trailer in that it has a lot of, it's more of an impressionistic presentation of the film. So give me a second while I, nope, that's the wrong, that's my inbox. You don't want to see my inbox. Hold on a second. Hold on, I've got to close some windows. Thought I had this all set up, Robert.
Don't worry about it, Ty.
Don't you hate it when the folders just close up on you without, okay, here we go. Now. Share a screen.
You were one of those lucky people that can travel anywhere.
Yes, ma'am.
And they sometimes call you nomads.
Mom said that you're homeless. Is that true?
No, I'm not homeless. I'm just
houseless.
Not the same thing, right?
No.
My husband worked at the USG mine in Empire. I was a substitute teacher.
It is a tough time right now. You may want to consider early retirement.
I need work. I like work.
Welcome to Badlands Spa.
What the nomads are doing is not that different than what the pioneers did. I think Fern's part of an American tradition.
My dad used to say, what's remembered lives. I maybe spent too much of my life just remembering.
One of the things I love most about this life is that there's no final goodbye. I've met hundreds of people out here. don't ever say a final goodbye. Let's just say I'll see you down the road. And I do. I see them again. And I can be certain in my heart, I'll see you again.
So it's the movie that, like I said, it's long been considered the front runner for Best Picture. It may very well win. It is directed by a woman born in China, but long working in America, Chloe Zhao, who made a wonderful small movie called The Rider about a rodeo rider a bunch of years ago. This is very much in the same vein in that it uses a lot of actual people from who the lives that she is focusing on, where that film used a lot of actual rodeo riders. Nomadland, everybody in the cast is, you know, people who are living the van life, except for Frances McDormand and David Strathairn, who is playing her sort of love interest in the film. But everybody else is a real person, which I think actually goes to one of the reasons that if you're coming to it cold, it doesn't feel like a Hollywood movie. It's, you know, there are no big performances. And in fact, you know, Frances McDormand is giving the character she plays is very sort of cantankerous and likes to keep to herself. That's actually sort of the dramatic arc. She doesn't want to come back into society. And at the same time, I think the film gives a portrait of America that we don't really, America as it stands now, that we don't usually see in films. It's very empathetic and sympathetic and observational about gig work and working at Amazon. How she got her cameras in there, I don't know. So McDormand is possibly favored to win Best Actress. She's won a number of run-up awards. I will say, let me talk briefly here about the Best Actress category, because unlike the Best Actor category, it is kind of crazy trying to figure out who's going to win it. The nominees for Best Actress are Viola Davis from Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, a film that was not nominated for Best Picture, which I find surprising. Andra Day, who's a newcomer, she's a singer, it's her first major acting performance, as Billie Holiday in the United States versus Billie Holiday. She won the Golden Globe. Vanessa Kirby for the melodrama Pieces of a Woman. Vanessa Kirby, you may remember for playing the young Princess Anne, or Princess Margaret in the first seasons of The Crown. Frances McDormand for A Nomadland, and Carey Mulligan for Promising Young Woman, which is a movie we'll be talking about in a little bit. To my money, it's a race between Frances McDormand and Viola Davis. It is interesting that for the first time we've got two Black women, two women of a color in the category. And it's also worth noting that for the first time we have two women in the directing category. And the first woman of color, Chloe Zhao, who is strongly favored to win. And I think that would be the first win for a woman since The Hurt Locker and Catherine, whose name I'm blanking out on for no reason whatsoever, Catherine Bigelow. So a separate conversation is that the Academy has been really pushing to diversify after being criticized quite heavily in recent years. And they have been inviting a lot of new members in over the past, I don't know, 5 years. Younger members, more international members, more members of color, and more women. And I actually think that that is beginning to have an effect on what wins, what gets nominated, and then what wins. I think that Parasite and Moonlight winning may be, in part, the scales may have been tipped by the younger and more diverse Academy members coming in. So yeah, that's a good thing. What else can I say about Nomadland? I think it is a lovely film if you come in expecting something quieter and more impressionistic. And I know my wife was very happy to see David Strathairn in there. She's been a fan for quite some time. The other film, let's sort of go down to the bottom of the list alphabetically. The other film that everybody thinks might win Best Picture is Trial of the Chicago 7. Which a lot of you have probably seen because it's been on Netflix. And it comes with a big pedigree. It's written and directed by Aaron Sorkin. It's a known quantity. It was originally supposed to be directed by Steven Spielberg back about 8 years ago. And for a variety of reasons that did not happen. I think there was a writer's strike or something going on. And Sorkin eventually just picked it up himself. It's got a very diverse cast. The cast actually just won the Screen Actors Guild Award for Ensemble Cast. Let me show you a trailer so you can get a sense of, if you haven't seen it, the Sorkin approach to history. Hold on a second. Where did my Zoom window go? There we go. Sorkin approach to history, which as we know it is, you can't handle the truth.
We want to underscore again that we're coming to Chicago peacefully, but whether we're given permits or not, we're coming.
We're going to Chicago to protest the Vietnam War.
And there's no place to be right now, but in it.
We watched for a decade while these rebels without a job tell us how to prosecute a war. They're going to spend their 30s in a federal facility, real time.
People say, you know, Abby, are you concerned about an overreaction from the cops?
Holy shit.
You all right?
The words are so there. Are the people ready to make opening arguments?
At the defense table.
Abby Hoffman, Jerry Rubin, Dave Dellinger, Randy Davis, Lee Weiner, John Freund, Tom Hayden, and Bobby Seale.
These defendants had a plan, and the plan was to incite a riot.
I call this portion of the trial with friends like these.
My trial's begun without my lawyer.
The court assumes you are being represented by the Black Panther sitting behind you.
The riots were started by the Chicago Police Department.
Sustained.
Nobody objected.
Jurors 6 and 11, they're with us.
Juror number 6 and juror number 11, you're dismissed from this jury.
Can you tell us why?
Because this is my courtroom.
We've dealt with jury tampering, wiretapping, a defendant that was literally gagged.
Get your hands off me!
You're the first to suggest that I have discriminated against a black man.
Then let the record show that I'm the second.
When we walked in here this morning, they were chanting that the whole world is watching.
If we leave here without saying anything about why we came in the first place, it'll be heartbreaking.
And last summer, why did you come to the convention?
To end the war.
We're giving them exactly what they want, a stage and an audience.
Hey, you really think there's going to be a big audience?
Here!
This is what revolution looks like, real revolution. We may have to hurt somebody's feelings.
Is this prosecution politically motivated?
Tired of hearing you. It would be impossible for me to care any less what you are tired of.
Here! There will be order!
We have to find some courage now.
What's your price? To call off the revolution?
My life.
Open your eyes, cause a new day is dawning.
All right, I'm going to stop it.
The new day is dawning.
The whole world is watching.
This is the kind of movie that, you know, in previous years would have like won a best picture award right out of the gate. It's got, you know, well-known actors playing famous people. It's a snapshot of a moment in history, a very dramatic moment in history. And you know, it's Sorkin being Sorkin with a lot of dramatic speeches and a lot of ironies. It's a fun watch. I mean, it's also eerily relevant to today for obvious reasons. But it is also an entertaining watch, which is what Sorkin does. That sounds like I'm sort of damning it with faint praise, and I sort of am. I like the movie, it's fun. I take issue with some of the presentations, you know, some of the performances in it. But I also think that if it won Best Picture, it would be a safe choice. And that's fine, but there are others I would prefer to see win. It's likely that Sorkin will win the Best Original Screenplay. He's up against Judas and the Black Messiah, Minari, Promising Young Woman, and Sound of Metal, which are all smaller independent films, which have their following, but Sorkin's kind of a brand name in this category. It doesn't mean he'll win, but it means that he's a brand name and he's a known figure. And I believe Sacha Baron Cohen is nominated for Best Supporting Actor as Abby Hoffman, in spite of one of the worst Worcester accents I've ever heard in a film. But I like Sacha Baron Cohen. He's a lot of fun in the film. And he is also, he had a good year with Borat, his latest Borat film. So he's very much in the mix. I think what I will talk about now is some of the lesser known titles. One that I think that's kind of sneaking up, I don't know if it's going to win Best Picture. It almost certainly won't. But if anything, it's in the Moonlight slot this year, in that it's the little movie that everybody who sees it is just completely falls in love with. And maybe the momentum's there, maybe not. And that movie is Minari. And it's a movie about made by a Korean-American filmmaker, Lee Isaac Chung, really about his growing up in a farm in America. It's about a Korean-American family in the 1980s that moves to Arkansas because the dad wants to start farming and grow Korean vegetables to sell to, at markets immigrants, and the struggles that they have. And it's an American story, which is completely ironic that the Golden Globes chose to nominate it only in the foreign language category because more than 50% of it is in Korean, although plenty of it is also in English. So the Globes got a bit of flack about that. But it's nominated in a great number of categories. It's nominated for Best Picture, as I said. Lee Isaac Chung, the director, is nominated for that category. It's nominated for his screenplay as well. Most satisfyingly, Steven Yeun, who is an actor you may recognize from Lost, done a lot of TV roles, been in a lot of movies. He plays the father in the film. He's nominated for Best Actor. Probably won't win, but there is a strong chance that in the supporting actress category, Yeo Jung Yoon, who plays the feisty grandmother in the film, she's pretty much odds-on favorite to take the Best Supporting Actress Oscar, a category that surprises every single year. So don't put your, don't bet on anything. But she did win the BAFTA award. She's won all the Critics Awards. It's a lovely performance and she's also a great winner. She gives hilarious speeches because she's just got a very tart sense of humor. And she's been in the Korean film industry for years and years. She's a huge star in Korea, unknown here. I'm going to show you the trailer from Minari. And if you have not seen it, I urge you to seek it out because it is a lovely, lovely film.
Steven, look, they're wheels.
Wheels?
여기 대체 어디야?
집이지. 새로 시작한다고 했잖아. 이게 그거야.
아빠는 빅 가든하러 만들 거야.
What a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. If you're here with us for the first time, please stand. What a beautiful family. Glad you're here.
Does your daddy like that new farm? He draws things good, doing things right.
Yes. 미국 애들은 할머니랑 같이 방 쓰는 거 싫어한다던데.
I don't like grandma.
걔는 안 그래요. 한국이니까.
Grandma smells like Korea.
야, 뭐라고? Grandma smell?
우리 여기 있다가 나갈 거야. 애들도 위해서라도 한 번 더 생각해 볼 수 있잖아. 애들도 한 번쯤 아빠가 뭔가 해내는 거 봐야 될 거 아니야. 와! 와!
얘들아, 이리와.
할머니는 진짜 할머니 같지 않아요.
할머니 같은 게 뭔데?
토끼도 만들고, 나뽀마도 안 해고, 먼저 팬티도 안 입고.
You need to find water somewhere. If that soil ain't wet, you're gonna lose your crop.
Oh, you pretty boy,
pretty boy.
I'm not pretty. I'm good looking.
So that is Minari. It's a treat. And I'm glad it's got as many nominations as it has. I only regret that the actress playing the mother, Yeri Han, who gives the quietest performance, but also in many ways the most powerful performance, one of the most powerful performances in the film, is not nominated. I don't think it's going to win. But if it was in the dark horse that came out of nowhere like Moonlight, I would be tickled pink. So that's Minari. Let's talk a little bit about the acting categories. I mentioned the best actress category, that it's kind of a toss up. Nobody knows who's gonna win it. It's a very strong field. Whereas the best supporting actress, Yeo Jong-yoon in Minari, is pretty much seems a lock. Anything could happen. But the best actor category is pretty much, everybody knows, it's one of those years where a great performance was given by a young actor who died, and Chadwick Boseman in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. And everybody pretty much agrees he should get the Oscar because it's a great performance, but also to memorialize this tragedy. Similar to when Heath Ledger won Best Supporting Actor for The Dark Knight. The only other time that has happened is when Peter Finch won Best Actor for Network back in 1977, I think, 1979. I don't remember the exact year, 77. Which is too bad for the other people in the category, because there's some really fine performances. I'm going to show you one again. Ma Rainey's Black Bottom did not get nominated for Best Picture, along with another film that's similar in that both are based on plays, both figure center on characters of color, both are directed by directors of color. That's One Night in Miami, which is the film that puts Muhammad Ali, Malcolm X, Sam Cooke, and Jim Brown in a hotel room together. Both of them are fine films, really moving, just absolutely worth your time. And I'm surprised that they did not make it into the Best Picture category, nor in the Best Directing category, because Regina King, who's an actress who won an Oscar couple of years ago for If Beale Street Could Talk, directed One Night in Miami and directed the hell out of it. And so those should be in the conversation, but nevertheless, Chadwick Boseman is almost certainly going to win Best Picture. That said, Anthony Hopkins gives one of the greatest performances of his career as the father, the title character in The Father, a elderly British man, a patriarch who is basically falling prey to dementia, and the film is sort of told from his point of view, again, based on a play, but directed by the playwright in his first film in a way that very cleverly keeps us and the main character off balance. And I'm gonna show you the trailer for that as well. Let me see if I can call it up. Olivia Colman, who plays his daughter, is nominated for Best Supporting Actress. She won that category a number of years ago for The Queen.
Friday, 31st of December, 1937.
You're living with your daughter at the moment?
Yes, until she goes to live in Paris.
No, Dad, why do you keep going on about Paris?
You told me.
No, I didn't.
I'm sorry, Anne, you told me the other day. Have you forgotten? She's forgotten. Paris. They don't even speak English there.
Dad, I'd like you to meet Laura. How do you do, sir?
I say, you're gorgeous.
Thank you. I must say, he's charming. Yeah, not always. Laura has come round to help you.
I don't need her or anyone else. I can manage very well on my own.
Everything all right?
Who are you?
Actually, it's me, Paul.
Who?
I live here.
What is this nonsense? Anne?
It's me.
Ah, there she is.
Your father seemed a bit confused.
Something wrong?
Where's Anne?
Sorry?
Anne, where is she?
I'm here. What's the matter, Dad?
Strange things going on around us.
Don't worry. Everything will sort itself out. Saw it in his eyes, didn't they, who I was? It was like I was a stranger to him. just did something to me.
I don't know what she's cooking up against me, but she's cooking something up.
What are you talking about, Dad?
I'm not leaving my flat! I am not leaving my flat! This really is my flat. Isn't it? You see, the situation is very simple. My daughter is of the opinion that I cannot manage on my own.
I'm so sorry about this.
Why? She understands perfectly.
It's important. I explained it all to you.
Why do you keep looking as if there's something wrong? Everything is fine.
I think she tries to do the best she can for you, Anthony.
Everything will be all right. I promise you.
There's something funny going on.
Hopkins, who is the oldest nominee ever in this category. If he won, he would be the oldest winner. He won the Best Actor at the BAFTA Awards. If anybody is going to challenge Chadwick Boseman for this particular award, it's he. I don't think Olivia Colman is going to take the Best Supporting Actress category award away from Yeo Jung-yoon, but one never knows. Glenn Close is nominated in this category for Hillbilly Elegy. She probably won't win, which would be the seventh time she's passed over. If she's nominated again and loses again, she would tie Peter O'Toole's record for never being nominated the most times without ever having won, which is kind of a tragedy because Glenn Close should win for something. Ann Whitaker, one of the attendees, says, "I don't think One Night in Miami translated well to a movie, or perhaps it could have with different directors, producers. Great opportunity for major Black actors and stories lost." I'd be curious to know why you didn't think it translated well to a movie. I thought given the difficulties of opening up a play and turning it into a movie, I thought they did quite well. But nevertheless, you're right, it is largely a one-set film, as is The Father. Although in The Father's case, the set keeps changing around the main character, which is one reason why I think it might possibly win the Art Direction Award, and it also might possibly win the Editing Award, because the craft of the Father plays really interesting tricks with the audience and on the main character. So I think I have time to really sort of talk in slightly more detail about two other films before we go to questions. Let's talk about Mank. The most nominated, probably least loved movie in this in the Best Picture category. Why do I say it's the best loved, least loved? Well, because everybody I talk to who is not a hardcore old film fanatic just doesn't like it at all, just finds it absolutely baffling. And see, here's the thing, I am a dyed-in-the-wool old film fanatic who's read all the histories, who knows everybody who's referenced in this in this movie. And this is absolute catnip to me. I mean, I get all the references, I get all the in-jokes. Me and all the other film critics out there and the film academics and the people who are really into film history and sort of pop culture history, which I would say, you know, consists of about 1% of 1% of the average movie going public. Now there are ways you can translate that to engage a wider movie going public, but David Fincher, the director, doesn't seem all that interested in this film. He wants to tell a story of the screenwriter, Herman J. Mankiewicz, and how, you know, he wrote Citizen Kane, and ironically, Orson Welles barely figures in this movie, and how he wrote Citizen Kane as sort of a futile act of vengeance against a powerful press baron and his ways of manipulating the political landscape of his country. And honestly, if that ain't a relevant topic to today, I don't know what is. But nevertheless, here's a film that is in black and white that assumes you know who Marion Davies is, assumes you know all this minutia because that's the enjoyment of watching it. It throws dialogue at you thick and fast, but if you don't know the players and you don't have a scorecard, you're just gonna tune it out. It's gonna be white noise. And I understand why majority of people just don't enjoy this film because it's Greek to them, which goes to an important point that we don't really think about that often. Not every film is for everybody. In fact, most films aren't for everybody. Most films are for a particular audience. Sometimes they're for a wide audience, Titanic. Sometimes they're for a very narrow audience, Mank. That said, it is not surprising that a voting body that is made up of people who make movies would give this movie about making movies a lot of nominations. Even if they don't know all the references and know all the people involved, it speaks their language. And it's a truism that movies about movie making always do well at the Oscars, at least get a lot of nominations. But I predict that this movie that got the most nominations of all will get no awards, or the most, maybe a production design award, maybe a screenwriting. Actually, no, it wasn't even nominated for its screenplay. A movie about a screenwriter was not nominated for its screenplay. How's that for a kick in the teeth? That I think is, people are gonna be spelling it as the big loser of the night. This is my prediction. I don't think it's gonna win anything in the first place. I love the movie. I really enjoy the movie, but it's a niche, it's got niche appeal. But the other, the one, probably the least known movie on this list, aside from Minari, and Judas and the Black Messiah, which has snuck into the conversation quite late and will probably win a Best Supporting Actor award for Daniel Kaluuya, who plays Fred Hampton, the Black Panther, who's actually in a small role in Trial of the Chicago 7, and who was assassinated, there's no other word for it, by the Chicago police and the FBI. The film tells his story and really tells the story of the man who betrayed him, played by Lakeith Stanfield, who is also nominated in the Best Supporting Actor category. That's an unusual double up there. But Kaluuya has been winning a lot of the awards running up to the Oscars. He gives an incredibly strong performance. He's well-loved from Get Out and previous films. It's kind of his to take. But the movie I want to talk about quickly before going to questions is Sound of Metal. I actually saw this at Sundance back in January, so over a year ago, and liked it quite a bit. Did not expect it to be quite such a major player in the Oscar race, and quite pleased to see so. And I think, it's the one that has benefited the most from the studios being out of the picture this year. This is a film, and I'll show you the trailer, about a rock musician, a sort of road warrior, played by the fine actor Riz Ahmed. He's a British actor, British Egyptian, I think. I'm sorry if I'm getting that wrong, but British born and raised. But he plays a rock drummer who goes deaf. He's also a recovering addict in this sense, tends to send him spiraling back. And it's about him coming to terms with his deafness in a sort of halfway house for rehab house for deaf addicts. And it is, I'm gonna show you the trailer and then talk a little bit about it. I think, where is it? It's on Amazon, I think, maybe on Hulu. It's one on the streaming platforms. And again, one that I kind of urge you to seek out if you haven't seen it. It's Prime Video, it's on Amazon. So here we go.
You sound great.
Yeah, right.
What, you told me you were feeling it? You're in it.
We don't need to put them all out.
I know, but we just keep them.
Your hearing is deteriorating rapidly.
We'll come back. Till then, Lou, we just keep going, okay?
No.
Lou, no. Let's play them all and see what it's like, okay? I'm gonna be like a click track. You can play to me. I can't hear you. Do you understand me? I can't. I'm dead.
Found a place.
I think it's important that you stay here with us right now, Ruben. We're looking for a solution to this. Not this.
I need you to wait for me, okay? You're it for me. Look at my heart. You're it for me, okay? You gotta wait for me.
Save my life. Ruben, the world does keep moving. It can be a damn cruel place. But those moments of stillness. When this crappy, mundane world suddenly becomes radiant and magnificent. All the fear is gone. That place will never abandon you.
So Riz Ahmed is nominated for Best Actor. Paul Racy, the guy who you see playing the sort of the leader of the halfway house there, who is an actor who is also the child of deaf adults, CODA, C-O-D-A, and has worked a lot in deaf theater as well as non-deaf theater. I just read a wonderful article about him. He's nominated for Best Supporting Actor and has won a lot of the run-up awards. And he's one of these journeyman actors who never expected his ship to come in the way it has with this. And that's one of the nice things about these kind of awards is that they sometimes just pluck people who've been working their entire lives, never expecting this kind of spotlight, sort of hoping, but you know, at his age, he sort of expected this was it. And now all of a sudden he's nominated for an Oscar. Is he gonna win? Probably not, because Daniel Kaluuya is going to win it, probably. But there's a lot of affection for him, and he's already getting, you know, a lot of offers to be in other movies. The other thing to note about this film is that, aside from the performances, which are terrific, is that the sound editing. This is one of the few movies where you can say, yeah, this absolutely deserves, an Oscar for sound. And again, as I mentioned, it's sort of sandwiched. The former two awards are now one award, Best Sound. When they sent critics, every year the studio sent out DVDs of the movies they want us to pay attention to. So we'll give them our end of the year awards. But they actually sent me a pair of headphones to watch this film. And normally, maybe we don't get that kind of swag, and I feel a little guilty for taking them, but I gave them to my daughter anyway. But I did. They wanted us to watch the film with headphones on because the sound mix mirrors what the main character, Ruben, is hearing. And it's really, I read an article as well about how they created that sound world, the film's sound world, and they created it. It didn't happen by accident. So that just speaks to the level of craft of some of these films. And really, Oscars are more about craft than they are really about glitz, in my estimation. But of course, we love the glitz. We love the red carpet, which we're not going to get this year. Some people love the red carpet. And I am going to open it up to questions now. There are a few movies I didn't talk about in the Best Picture category. Promising Young Woman, which certainly should be talked about, and Judas and the Black Messiah. Those are the other two in that category. But if you have questions, put them in the chat box, and we will discuss back and forth. And if there are no questions, I'll just keep yapping on about the movies.
And so, Ty, there are also a couple of questions in the Q&A box. I don't know if you see those as well.
Oh, yes, there it is. Let me pop that open. Okay, hello. What factors, aside from the quality of film itself, do you think affect Oscar wins? That's from Michael Tricca, I'm sure I'm pronouncing that wrong. There is a sort of political and social hot button issue factor, unquestionably. Nomadland, one of the reasons it's in the mix is that it speaks to what's going on in the country today. I think that the fact that that there are a satisfyingly large number of actors of color in the acting categories is both a good thing because it reflects the performances, but it is also, I think, a result of a concerted effort by the Academy to bring in a larger voting body and to just pay attention to a broader diversity So yes, sometimes there are films that are maybe not great quality. And honestly, I think quality is less a, you know, what do you mean by quality? That's a very vague categorization. The best film, the best made film, the one that makes you feel the best. A couple of years ago, what was the one with Viggo Mortensen and Green Book won, which is a movie that makes a lot of people feel good that I thought was kind of cooked up. It was probably my least favorite to win, but it was most people's favorite to win. And that was a real crowd pleaser, and there's nothing wrong with that. But it also sort of scratched the sort of, we can fix racism itch, which is something that, you know, goes back to Driving Miss Daisy and other films in that sort of area. So yes, there is a social factor. Every now and then there's a huge blockbuster that just steamrollers the competition, and it's just the major talking point of the year, Titanic being one, the Return of the King, the final Lord of the Rings movie being another, that it has to be just honored. So there are always, every year it's a different bunch of factors. And like I said, the one that wins is the one that makes the most people feel best about what they do at the moment they're filling out the ballot. And that can change. And honestly, you never know who's filling out the ballot. I'll tell you a quick story and then I'll go on to the next question. So I live in Newton, and one day a bunch of years ago, I was walking my dog in one of the parks out here, and I ran into a friend, and she said, "Hey Ty, I'm voting for the Oscars tonight." I said, "What?" She says, "Well, one of my closest friends from college, her mother is in the Academy. She was in the costume branch of the Academy, and she gets the ballot every year, but her mother has Alzheimer's. So every year the daughter sits down and picks a friend, and we pick we vote on the Oscars for her." So you never know who's filling out that ballot, especially in past years when the average age of the membership was somewhat north of 60, quite north of 60. And I've also heard tales of people giving it, you know, in Beverly Hills, giving it to their gardener or, you know, whatever. So let's just say the sample is a little bit fuzzy there. Other questions. What's the best way to see the nominated shorts? Wayne Geyser asks. They are available right now, and actually through for virtual screening through a number of those independent theaters that I'm talking about. If you go to the Coolidge Corners website, you can find, I think they're still available. You can buy tickets and watch the, I think the Coolidge Corner is the only one showing the animated shorts, the live action shorts, and the documentary shorts. The Brattle is doing it as well. Maybe it's the Kendall Square. Check those three. And you'll be able to see them. What did you think of Promising Young Woman? I thought it was extremely well done. Christine Woods asked. Yeah, I'm sorry I sort of short shrifted that one. That is the controversial film in this year's Best Picture race. It's a movie that stirs up a lot of heat and gets a lot of people upset for interesting reasons. It's about a young woman played by Carey Mulligan, who was nominated for Best Actress, who entraps men into trying to rape her, basically. She plays drunk and then turns the tables on them in very various vengeful ways. And because she's avenging the suicide, this is not really giving away too much, of a close friend who was raped in college, and then it was covered up, and she was not believed. So obviously it's a movie that presses a lot of hot buttons and is written and directed by a woman named Emerald Fennell. She's an actress. She played, I'm having trouble with the names tonight, Prince Charles, Camilla Parker Bowles in the recent seasons of The Crown. Well, she's a writer and director as well. And she's now nominated for Best Director It's a fearsome movie. It has an ending that I will not give away, or a twist, climactic twist that I will not give away, that makes some people really, really angry, including a lot of young women I know, and some other people, including a lot of young women I know, really not cheering, because that's not the right word for it, but think that's the right way for the film to go. If you haven't seen it, see it, but prepare to engage with a very fierce, uncompromising film. Do I think it's going to win anything? I don't think Carey Mulligan might squeak out a Best Actress. It's a great performance. It might win a screenplay award. I don't think it's going to win. I don't think Emerald Fennell is going to take director away from Chloe Zhao, but one never knows. How does one become a professional film critic, and what is your background? What is my background? Briefly, I was a teenage film geek. Let's just put it that way. I discovered the Marx Brothers at age 14 and went down a deep rabbit hole of classic films back when before there was videotape, I grew up in Brookline, and I would go into Boston to all the revival houses showing old movies. I studied film. I was a film studies major at Dartmouth and also at NYU. And I was writing at an early age about film. Did a thesis on film melodrama. In other words, I've been studying and writing about film, about movies, from a deep love of movies. I didn't get into this because I don't like movies, all my life. We say everyone's a critic, and yeah, everyone is a critic. You come out of a movie and you have thoughts about it, and you argue with your friends, and it's one of the few, you know, not everybody's an architecture critic, not everybody's a dance critic, but everybody's a movie critic. And that's fine. But the people who do it professionally, hopefully, come from a position of reasonable expertise, of reasonable knowledge, and which can back you into a corner of being a connoisseur, hopefully not a snob, but maybe being a little jaded with the usual things that studios purvey, the ones that are just out there to make money, and more attentive to ones that do things differently. I wouldn't say that's a danger of the job, but it is a thing that comes, you know, as with any field in which you strive to become knowledgeable, you end up becoming, to some degree, a connoisseur. That's the wrong word. That makes it sound like I'm building myself up. But I've seen a ton of movies. I've written about a ton of movies. And, you know, so I assume I've got a level of knowledge that will inform the stuff I write with a context that will be useful to the readers. At the end of the day, my opinion is my opinion, but the context, the information I provide, will hopefully broaden, not just help you decide whether to see the movie, but broaden your understanding of it and add to the discussion. Joan Warnschwitz says, will you add Newburyport screening room to your small art film locations? A real favorite in Merrimack Valley. Absolutely, I've never been there. I would like to go there. I love Newburyport. I've go there a lot, but I've never actually been to the theater there. So when the pandemic is over, I'll make a point of going there with my wife. But absolutely, support your local art house. Absolutely, please support your local art house. Support your local multiplex these days, because they are in danger. They are going to bounce back with difficulty from the pandemic. And the art houses as well. There's a West Coast chain, Arclight Cinemas, that opened up just before the pandemic. Lousy timing. A theater in Boston, downtown, near North Station. That it was open for, I don't know, 6 months, and the pandemic hit. And the Arclight has just gone out of business, has shut down their entire chain. And they were the premier, they were like the Coolidge Corner, the Newbury, art house of LA. So everybody I know in LA is gnashing their teeth that this is gone. Can you comment on News of the World with Tom Hanks, says Ann Sullivan. Yeah, I can comment on it. It's a lovely film. It's a Tom Hanks film. It's based on a novel that I want to read. It's a Western. It's Tom Hanks in a Western, which kind of makes sense. We always think of Tom Hanks as our Jimmy Stewart, and Jimmy Stewart made some fantastic Westerns in the 50s. If you haven't seen any of the Westerns Jimmy Stewart made with Anthony Mann, Bend of the River, Naked Spur, I urge you to catch them. He plays a former Civil War soldier traveling throughout America, reading the newspapers to small towns, and befriends a young orphan who has been living with Native Americans, with an Indian tribe, Native American tribe, for years, and he has to take her back to her family. against some stiff odds. It's a good movie. It's an example of the kind of studio sort of prestige film that might have gotten more attention in a different year, but kind of fell through the cracks. It is nominated for a couple of, I think, a handful of awards. It's original score. Helena Zengel, the young German actress, I think it's about 12, who plays the girl, has won some other awards, wasn't nominated for an Oscar. Hanks, you know, wasn't nominated for anything, but we still all love Tom Hanks, and you know, he's won his two Oscars already. So you should definitely see it. It's a fine film. Lynn Scarfo asks, have you seen the Bill Mayer bit on the Oscars saying it should be called the Debbies, as in Debbie Downers, as Hollywood is creating movies that are all downers rather than aiming at optimistic entertainment? I have not seen that bit. I've heard of it. I don't feel like I have to see it to see it. You know, Bill Maher is a master of snark, and there are plenty of movies that aren't nominated for Oscars that that do all those things that he's talking about. I think some years the Oscars have always been about Hollywood awarding its more serious impulses from the very beginning, its more artful impulses, even when it was the studio, the major studios running the show. The pure entertainments have rarely, especially in recent years, been in the mix, in part because I say it's about the Academy members wanting to put their best foot forward and say, here's what we feel proudest about what we do. And yeah, social factors factor into that. You know, we get a lot of feel good stuff in other areas of our culture, and I don't mind that these movies make us feel things. I don't think Sound of Metal makes me feel bad. Sound of Metal makes me feel good. But not in a bad way. And I sort of take exception for Bill Maher for saying that. I think Nomadland actually makes me feel good feelings and moving feelings about the people it shows. Minari makes me feel wonderful. You know, so stuff at Bill Maher. Go watch these movies. I'm sorry. You know, it gets good sound bites, but I don't have the patience for that nonsense. Sorry. John Moriarty says, would you agree that the Academy should include a category for best stunt choreography? No, I don't agree. I think it's a great category. I don't necessarily agree that there should be the Oscars are long enough as it is. I'd like to see a category for best ensemble cast before I see one for best stunt choreography. But sure, there are, I guess does the stuntman have its own guild? The stuntman, you know, craft? I'm sure it does. I don't know. I should know what it is, and I don't. I'm sure they give out awards. I'd actually love to see all the crafts better represented, because we don't think about those crafts when we watch a movie. And we don't think about, you know, all the stunt people who are literally risking their necks when they make these films and go home sort of unrewarded. That was one of the fun things about watching that last Quentin Tarantino movie, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, which obviously had some serious aspects, but the look behind the scenes it gave you toward the sort of stuntman community, among other things, I thought was welcome and necessary and needed. Ann Whitaker asks, if you made your own film, what subject would it be on, or genre? I will say that this canard that the critics are critics because they don't create, because they're failed, you know, frustrated creators, is, in my case, certainly not true. I have written screenplays in the past for, you know, in college and early in my life. They were terrible. I'm a terrible screenwriter. I'd probably be a terrible director. I don't want to do it. I love writing about movies, thinking about movies, getting people to go to movies they wouldn't otherwise see and think about. I don't see myself as wanting to make movies, but I do have my favorite genres. I have a real sweet tooth for romantic comedies. A great romantic comedy, a great smart romantic comedy is pure pleasure to me. And I'm thinking about, you know, the great Nora Ephron ones. I'm thinking about the great ones from Hollywood, the classic era, Philadelphia Story, Chopper on the Corner. I'm thinking of, you know, When Harry Met Sally. I'm even thinking, I've got a sweet tooth for the dumb ones too. You know, like one of my favorite stupid movies is what's it called? The post box. It's the one with Keanu Reeves and Sandra Bullock about a magic post box that lets them send letters to each other, even though they're 2 years apart. It's the stupidest movie I've ever seen, but I really enjoy it. I do like great musicals. I have a great, and they don't make good ones anymore. And when they do, I'm happy to see them. I like a great action film. Aliens to me, not the second one. I think the first one's fine. Great, love it. The second one to me is one of the great action movies of all time. It's important to me as a critic to be able to at least appreciate every single genre and be able to write from a position of potential appreciation. So for instance, even though I don't, my least favorite genre is bloody horror, gory horror, when it's really lazily done, when it's just chop up some teens and let's make some money over the first few weekends. That to me is, there's no interest in that. If there's a sense of intelligence there, a sense of wit, a sense of, you know, humor, sure, I'll go along with it. You know, I'm not a fan of gore, but I will, you know, watch through my fingers. If it's the people who are making it care about what they're doing. And Catherine Riley asks a related question. What genre do you think doesn't get enough respect at the Oscars? The well-made entertainment films. The ones that are, and you know, I have to say, I'm not the biggest fan of superhero franchise films. I like them when they're well done. I like them when they've got a sense of humor about themselves. I think that they've taken over Hollywood. They've taken over and they've driven out the mid-range dramas and comedies and romances. And then those only get made now on Amazon and Netflix. And we don't see them in the theaters anymore because the only thing that gets made by the big studios are these franchise films, the Harry Potters and the Star Wars and the Star Treks and the Avengers and now the DCs. And again, I enjoy them for what they are, but I think that they have kind of borged the movies. And I think that's a shame. So those mid-range romances, comedies, dramas, those meat and potato movies, when they're well-made, when the people who make them care about what they're doing and the scripts are smart, you know, not super smart, they don't have to be intellectual, but just made by people who know how to put dialogue together and can write a sentence. Those, I think, that kind of meat and potato filmmaking doesn't get recognized enough at the Oscars. Robert, how are we doing for time? Can I answer a couple of questions?
Yeah, okay. So why don't we make Amir's comment and question the last one as we approach 8:15. So if you want to read that one, Ty, and let her know if the Boston Film Festival is still around.
Okay. Amir, I lived here long ago and was a huge fan of the Boston Film Festival, the Boston Globe, and you. Thank you. I even arranged to take my vacation then and see as many films as possible. I recently moved back here, but I haven't heard it mentioned. I'm assuming you mean the Boston Film Festival. Is it still around? Oh, thereby hangs a tale. I'm assuming you're talking about the Boston Film Festival back in the 80s and even early 90s before I came back to Boston in 2002, when the Boston Film Festival was pretty much the only festival in town. And I had a respectable run and attracted Hollywood filmmakers. You know, and the trick about a city film festival, aside from like a major city film festival, and in terms of film festivals, Boston is kind of a second tier film festival location, as opposed to New York, LA, San Francisco, and Sundance, you know, and Toronto. So it's tough to get filmmakers to show up with their films, even though increasingly a lot of them are being shot here because of the tax benefits. But the Boston Film Festival had a pretty good run, and then it changed hands. The couple that had run it for many, many years retired and passed it over to a woman named Robin Dawson, who had been previously running the Boston Film Office. I don't want to be too negative here, but she has kind of turned it into her personal boutique film festival and run it into the ground. And it's not particularly an important film festival. There are a number of disasters where she brought filmmakers out and got the wrong print or screwed up the, you know, Q&A. I mean, it really just stopped being a professional film festival. And unfortunately, because they retain the legal rights to the name Boston Film Festival, it's still held every year in various venues, but it doesn't get a lot of coverage, and it's more of a social event for a certain level of Boston society and Boston film personnel than it is a serious film event. And I say that with sorrow. However, the festival that you want to pay attention to, in that it is curated, as opposed to, there's a lot of film festivals in Boston, and most of them are pay to play. In other words, you can get your film in that festival if you pay them $200. You know, you fill out an entrance form and you pay the entrance fee and boom, you're in there. That to me is, it's a useful marketplace and it helps people get their films seen. As a critic, I don't pay that much attention to them. But the festivals like Sundance, like the Miami Film Festival, the Woods Hole Film Festival, those are curated film festivals in which a programmer goes to a lot of film festivals, looks at as many films as they can, and chooses what they, you know, want to be in there. The one that's doing that now is called the Independent Film Festival of Boston. It's run by a couple of people. It was actually started by a guy who's a film worker, handful of people now, you know, 15 years ago it's been around, who started it because the Boston Film Festival wasn't doing it. There wasn't a real true film festival in Boston. They're still a shoestring operation, but every year they get the best from Sundance, from Toronto, from Telluride. They do a great job. They are in the spring. They're held every spring with a fall focus festival. They are held usually primarily at the Somerville Theater, but there's usually a couple of events at the Coolidge and the Brattle. They did a lot of stuff online. One of the interesting things about this past year and with the pandemic is that all the major film festivals readily adapted to online screening. So I was able to go to Sundance I went to in last January, 2020 in person, but 2021, I did it virtually. I went to the Toronto Film Festival virtually. I went to South by Southwest virtually. And they did a very good job at the back end in terms of streaming their films with very few glitches. And the Boston Independent Film Festival of Boston, which is at, I believe, iffboston.org, if you want to check them out. And they have screenings throughout the year. Please support them. What they are doing is really, really good. Like I said, you know, they're always kind of running on oxygen, running on fumes, but they do, they're the real film festival in this city. And I hope to someday, they get the rights to use Boston Film Festival, because that's what they are. That's in truth what they are. So yeah, Amir, patronize them. All right.
Great. So Ty, any last words you want to give to those here live before we wrap up?
No, I think I've kind of covered it here. Watch a lot of movies, stretch yourself, but have fun. Watch the Oscars. That's going to be very weird this year. They're going to be hosting it at both in Penn Station in New York or somewhere. No, maybe it's the LA. I think it's the LA station, and in the Kodak Theater or the Dolby Theater. And they're promising not to do Zooming. I don't know how they're going to make it work, but it's going to be interesting. But more to the point, support films and support your local theater, because that's the way to keep this art form alive. Thank you. Thank you for showing up.
Excellent. Great. Well, I'm going to make some friendly wagers with some folks, and I'm going to go with, Nomadland. We're going to go with Chadwick Boseman.
Yep.
And we're going to go with I'm going to go with Viola Davis anyway, who I love from How to Get Away with Murder. But if I'm wrong on any of those, I'm going to blame you.
Please do. Please do. Many, many people do, and I can take it.
Great. Well, I want to thank Ty for a wonderful evening. I want to thank the libraries in Andover, Chelmsford, North Reading, Tewksbury, and Wilmington. And most importantly, I want to thank all of you on Zoom for watching. Hope you really enjoyed it. And look for that email from me tomorrow morning with a link to a feedback survey. Please take 30 seconds and fill that form out. Let us know what you thought. So thanks so much, Ty. And I hope everyone enjoys the Oscars in a couple of weeks.
Thank you. Thanks, Robert, for having me. And thank you guys for showing up. I really appreciate it. I hope to meet you in person someday.
There you go. Have a great night, everyone. Bye-bye.
Take care.